Well, that was a clip from the recently released film Brazil, and we're very fortunate to have with us today in the studio the director and co-screenwriter of that film, Terry Gilliam. Welcome to Imperial, Terry. Thank you very much for coming. We'll actually be returning to that film a little later on, it being your latest effort, but first perhaps we could set the scene a little bit. According to my notes, you were born in Minneapolis, which is in Minnesota, I believe, in the USA, and majored in political science.
A bit later, after the birth.
Yes.
Started majoring in political science.
Yes, yeah. After you'd got past the drooling and dribbling
stage. The birth was difficult because my mother wasn't there at the time. I had to do it all myself.
You ran the college literary magazine. And
into the ground. Is the way the sentence finishes, I think.
Well, no, that's not what it says here.
No.
It can't have been too far into the ground, because you actually so impressed Harvey Kurtzman, of course, quite famous for the magazine Mad, into giving you a job as an assistant editor.
It wasn't actually quite like that, because I'd been sending the magazines to New York. He was doing a magazine at the time called Help, which, unbeknownst to most of the world, was being co-edited by Gloria Steinem, famous for changing the face of women across America. And I was sending him copies of our college humor magazine, and he was very complimentary about it. And after I graduated, I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know what I was doing before I graduated, but after I graduated, I didn't know what I was going to do with my life. And so I went off and was counseling at a summer camp somewhere up in the Sierras, and I decided to go to New York to meet Harvey, and he sent very strong letters back warning me not to do this, that New York was not the place for a young lad from California, and I persisted and went there. And it was absolutely extraordinary, because I walked into the Algonquin Hotel, which he had set up in a suite up there to do some cartoons, and he had captured all the best cartoonists of his generation, all my great idols, and they were all in this room working on what was to become a thing called Little Annie Fanny and Playboy. And I walked into this hotel room, it was absolutely extraordinary. There they were, all my heroes. And the guy who was the assistant editor on the magazine was quitting, and they were looking desperately for somebody to take his place, and I walked into the job. It was amazing. So for 3 years in New York, I worked on this magazine, and it was terrifying, but it's very embarrassing when you're an editor, because you're supposed to be in control, in charge, all of these things. It's like directing films, you're supposed to be in control, in charge, and the fact is you don't usually know what you're doing. And it's a terrible cover-up to try to fool people into believing in you. So I think you wear lots of big signs saying director or editor, and hopefully they read well.
So you did actually have an instinctive feel for directing, for actually making things look the right way.
I think so. I mean, I think it's a thing you learn. I mean, I think the strongest thing has been the fact that I've been a cartoonist all my life, which is really handy. I mean, you carry around a portfolio of drawings, and you go into a door and you say, this is what I do, boom, boom, and you don't have to sit and explain how terrific a person you are, and great fun, and a terrific leader, and all that, you just do that. So I always worked from that premise of doing work that I had control over, that I didn't have to try to please anybody else, and once you start controlling your drawings, you can then control everything else that goes along. You've got to learn the jobs, but something about doing a drawing and then making a film, it's not that far different somehow.
I presume you sort of sketch out your films in a storyboard type
Yeah, they used to be far more elaborate. I used to do really nice ones on Jabberwocky and Holy Grail, but I've gotten more and more frenzied when I start working on a film, and I don't care about doing beautiful drawings. The difficulty was both in Holy Grail and Jabberwocky, my drawings, because my training as a cartoonist, I tend to distort figures, so you end up with big heads, little bodies. And I'd do the frames and draw these things in there. And the difficulty was, once the real actors would turn up on the set, they didn't fit like that. They had normal-sized heads and regular-sized bodies, and I couldn't squash them into these frames like I did the drawings. So I've stopped doing those sort of precise drawings, and they're more general sketches, so that hopefully the actors have a bit of room to maneuver.
Yeah, I suppose you could almost say in Time Bandit you actually sort of made the actor smaller.
No, you spotted it. That's exactly what happened. It was suddenly easy. My drawings came to life and they fitted in the frames just like that. The other great thing about something like Time Bandits is because if your lead actors are 4 feet tall, all the sets look, again, mammoth. And so it's a fairly cheap film for the scale it looks. Yeah, I after Help magazine had sort of folded in New York, I decided to to just, I'd saved up a bit of money, so I hitchhiked around Europe for about 6 months and was just fascinated by the place. I thought, this is the stuff life is made of, you know, the castles on hills, people speaking strange accents, you know, there's life going on. And it seemed a lot more real to me than America. And I was tempted to stay, but being a coward, I rushed back to the States just to make sure I wasn't deluding myself. And after about a year and a half in the States, I realized I didn't want to stay there anymore because 67 had arrived and America was really in turmoil. And I had naively believed in things like truth, justice, and the American way, all of the things.
The frontier spirit.
Yes, all of those things. And somehow it was all changing. You know, being hit over the head by a policeman's baton is very disturbing. And being stopped because you have hair of a certain length is very annoying. And little by little, I was getting disillusioned with the place and decided either I had to become far more involved in what was going on politically or get out and carry on doing silly drawings. And I chose the latter. And when I got to London, I continued doing freelance illustrating and was working in magazines, but I was getting more and more tired of magazine work. And I knew John Cleese because I had had him do a job on Help magazine. We did these things called fumetti, which were like comic strips, only use photographs of real people and they talk with balloons. And yes, we did one with John as a man who fell in love with a Barbie doll. And it proved to be prophetic, but we didn't know that at the time. And when I came to London, John was by then well established in television, and he introduced me to some people. And one of the people was Humphrey Barclay, who was producing Do Not Adjust Your Set, which Mike Palin, Terry Jones, and Eric Idle were doing, and the Bonzo Dog Band, and David Jason, and King's Coffee, and a lot of other people.
Of course, you sort of remained basically better known for the animation in, well, all the Python series, and of course now for something completely different, which eventually came out of it, a compilation in 1971. 1975, Monty Python and the Holy Grail, the first sort of post-TV type Python full-length film. You co-directed that with Terry Jones.
Well, again, that was
the two Terrys, I suppose.
Yes, exactly. Foolish arrogance it was, and we just assumed. Again, it was this thing about control, about trying to, because that's what Python even began with. We were writers who got tired of other people doing the material badly, so one starts performing it, and then we had to direct the stuff eventually. That was the way it seemed to develop. And Terry and I did it, and again, neither of us had directed a feature film before, and it seemed the quickest way to learn how was to actually make one, and so we made Holy Grail. And looking back, I don't know how we did it. It was extraordinary. I mean, we did it in 5 weeks, and it was madness because with two directors not always agreeing on what the direction was we were going, it was quite extraordinary. I mean, Terry'd say this, I'd say that, and Jerry Harrison, who was the first assistant director, he was trying to bring the two of us together, he'd say that, and so the crew was just going crazy. But we got it done somehow.
And then, of course, we come on to Jabberwocky. Mm. Jabberwocky isn't really a Python film, is it, in the same way as Monty Python and the Holy Grail explicitly was and was billed as such. Do you think it was perhaps a bit of a mistake in terms of juxtaposition to do another medieval film, which wasn't meant to be a Monty Python film, and put Michael Palin in the leading role?
This is the work of a very stupid human being. I mean, I don't know what it was either. It was, I was so arrogant or I was so stupid. It was one of the two things that I actually thought people could, you could expect people to go out there and not be confused by the two things. In the States, they actually sold it as Monty Python's Jabberwocky. But I wasn't really thinking in those terms. I just wanted to try to do the things I wasn't able to do in Holy Grail. And I don't really think about whether it's going to be a commercial success or who the public is or any of those sort of intelligent questions that one's supposed to consider when one makes a film.
Did you pick up some sort of bug about the Middle Ages when you were actually hiking around Europe? Because you mentioned castles, a feeling of history, something you don't really have in the States.
Yeah.
Sort of a long, long line of things into the past.
I don't think I picked up the bug going around Europe. I think it had always been there. It was sort of, you know, a faceless, formless disease.
Just waiting to leap out of a cupboard at you.
That's it. I mean, I'd always, you know, fairy tales had always fascinated me. All the films, you know, with Ivanhoe and any El Cid, all of those things. He just loved all that. I mean, pageantry and panoply and castles and they just seemed very magical, all of those things to me always. And suddenly being in Europe, it was even more magical because it was both real and it was still just as magical, even more magical, because unlike the Hollywood versions, which all seemed to be intact and nice, crisp stonework, the real things were all crumbling, and it was had a sense of decay about it, which made it even more romantic in that sense.
Yes, of course, the Hollywood versions and perhaps the version in people's minds of the Middle Ages tend to be rather sanitized, don't they? There's none of the sort of the real blood, guts, squalor, gangrenous, sores and wounds and the Black Death, things like that. That's something which you haven't chosen to omit from your films.
No, I've tried to redress the balance, especially with Jabberwocky. I mean, Jabberwocky is a truly filthy film. I mean, it's disgusting. Yes. I mean, every tooth in every mouth is either black or decayed or broken. Every bit of every building is crumbling or dusty. It was that obsession with trying to balance what Hollywood had, the images Hollywood had given us, and I may have taken it to extremes. I was more obsessed with Bruegel and Bosch as well, where everybody, in some corner of every picture, there's somebody down there either peeing or taking a shit. And it was like the toilet training period of history, I think, the Middle Ages somehow. People seemed to be very in touch with their bodies, and I don't know, it was a strange time. I liked also the fact that demons seemed to be tangible things. They weren't strange abstract concepts. They were there. They were biting into your head. They were ripping out your entrails. And it seemed to be more, I think maybe it's the Tom and Jerry period of history. I'm not sure.
How did you actually design the Jabberwock itself, the monster, which is possibly one of the most endearing things about the whole film? It's a very nice monster.
He is. I mean, I got a soft spot for monsters. What was amazing is I've been looking at a lot of films, monster films, trying to see the sort of monsters they did. And they all bothered me because either they were stop-motion animation, which we all could recognize, or they were people in monster suits walking around. And the thing that ultimately always gave them away is their knees bent, the same way human knees bend. And one night I was just drawing up this thing. I said, what happens? Because the easiest way to run a monster is to have somebody inside it, rather than a lot of machinery. And so I just designed the thing so the man stood backwards in it. So where his heels were now became the claws of the feet, and his knees bent backwards like a chicken.
Like a bird.
Yeah, and his arms then could be the motive force for the wings. Mm-hmm. And then the head was a puppet affair that was off wires, so that worked separately. And it worked, and it was really nice because I don't think you can see the man in the monster. The monster seems to work, and it was easy for us to maneuver it. And actually, one of the nicest shots in the film is when the monster dies, because it was a mistake. The guy inside it tripped and fell. And something about the way people fall when they fall for real is quite different than the way people fall when they're being paid to fall. And it was just magic, and we managed to get it on the camera. So I completely rewrote the fight at that point. So that monster dies, and we saved a week's shooting.
And so a hero, albeit a slightly reluctant one, is born, I suppose, Pale, and that's towards the end of the film, of course. Jabberwocky, your first film you did on your own. 1979, sort of 2 years after this, we have Life of Brian. Yeah. Now, that was a Python film.
Indeed.
It wasn't your direction. You were the art director, I believe, of that film.
Yeah, I decided, I thought it was too much to continue with this two directors routine. What I did do, which got me interested in the things that followed, was the spaceship sequence in there, when Brian falls into the spaceship. That was my little bit in the film, besides the animation. And that was the first attempt at special effects, and, well, then it goes on from there with the other films.
Were you surprised by the adverse reaction to the film? I mean, I'm talking obviously about charges of blasphemy and people generally getting fairly worked up. In fact, I believe you actually subpoenaed in America as an American citizen.
I think all the people we meant to offend were offended, which seems reasonable. I don't think anybody with anyone who didn't have a vested interest in organized religions seemed to get too angry about the thing.
It all had a happy ending in the
On the Sheffield, actually, is where the happy ending occurred, because, you know, as the Sheffield was sinking in the South Atlantic, as the sailors were being pulled off by helicopters, they all sat on the deck, or stood on the deck, singing, "Always look on the bright side of life." You didn't know that, did you?
No, I must confess, I didn't.
That's true.
Was that leaked by Clive Ponty, by any chance?
I wonder.
So, Life of Brian. If we come on after that to Time Bandits. Mm. Now, you were thinking about Brazil at this time, I believe, at the time of Time Bandits, but you didn't or couldn't do it at that time. Why was that? No one would give you the money.
No.
So you did Time Bandits instead.
Yeah, I just knocked that one off because Brazil was obviously not ever going to be financed by the people we were involved with, and Time Bandits was a desperate bid to do a commercial hit.
And a very successful bid it was, of course, because that is, if anything, hopefully, until now, of course, with Brazil, your most successful film.
It was extraordinary. I mean, in America, it was really huge. It was difficult. It was trying to convince people that you could actually make a film for all the family. This concept was out the window. I mean, Disney was the only one that ever achieved that, and all of the recent Disney films had been failures. So the idea of making a film that both, you know, 5-year-old kids or 80-year-old adults could go and see and enjoy for different reasons was something they wouldn't consider. It was really irritating, but in the end, George Harrison came to the rescue and gave us the money, and we made it again, no strings attached, and we blew up the parents at the end of the film, and still the money came in.
So a great success all round. I'll skate over Meaning of Life.
Yes, a disgusting little film that I don't think we should soil the program with even the mention of, frankly.
And come straight on to Brazil then, your latest film. Now, you were thinking about this, 4 years ago?
Even longer, actually. I mean, I found my first notes were written when we were looking for locations for Jabberwocky, so it's been lingering on the back burner for some time. It's something that I just felt I had to, again, get out of my system. I was just getting more and more angry as things were getting more and more confused. It was a film about frustration and things like that. And I think it's 1984 approach. I like the idea of doing a film that related to the year 1984, not so much the novel 1984, but the year. And thank God we didn't, because we were trying to get it out for Christmas 83, and that was the year that Herod's blew up, which, if you've seen Brazil, is about things blowing up and people carrying on despite the mayhem. And I think it would have been probably the worst taste film of all time, but thank God we were so inefficient, we only just managed to get it out now.
You didn't get it finished in time. Yes, it's funny you should mention 1984, because having seen the film, there is quite a lot of a 1984 feel about it. The same sort of forbidden love, as it were, the mammoth bureaucracy where sort of the individuality is almost snuffed out, as it were, where the great oppressive machinery of bureaucracy. Even, I suppose, the parallel with him ending up under the being tortured by his best friend, also another 1984 image. And of course, you were thinking about this 4 or 5 years ago, long before the film 1984, which was recently coming out, was released. Was that sort of in your mind from the book? Presumably you had read the book.
No, I haven't.
You haven't?
No, this is what's wonderful. I'm really proud to be able to say I've never read the book. But that doesn't excuse me in any way, because I think everybody with any education knows the book. The story is well known, so it's part of the culture. But no, actually, just before we started filming Brazil, I actually bought the book and I was going to read it, and then realized, wait, this is the first question I'm going to be asked, so I'm not going to read it.
Really cross the interviewers up being able to say no.
But no, they're definitely... What's interesting is there are more similarities than I even knew, because having now seen the film and know a bit more of the details of the book, things like the valley that appear in the film, appear in the book as well. I didn't realize that. And yes. I mean, it's very... I love that sort of coincidence that that things seem to be in the air at the same time. But no, I didn't know any of those sort of details. I think the difference is that ours is more about humanity. I'm not sure. 1984 is more about a system and the repression of humanity. I mean, I find all of our people, even the clerks in the pool, each one, they've all got little things going on. They're retaliating against their boss by turning the TVs on to old films.
They're not conforming, basically.
Yeah. I mean, ultimately, there's a system, there's a huge bureaucracy, but it isn't as oppressive as I think some people make it out to be, because shopping centers seem to be full of people busily shopping, the restaurants are rich. There's a lot of life going on there. There's also bureaucracy working, which, if you happen to work for it, I suppose, if your hero works for this bureaucracy, it must be rather important in the film.
Yes. But also a lot of very petty type bureaucracy. I'm thinking particularly of right at the beginning of the film, where the rather distraught wife, for instance, has to sign receipts before her husband is actually allowed to be taken away to interrogation. And the head waiter, for instance, also in the restaurant scene, sort of insisting, sort of, it is the rule, you can't ask for it by name, you've got to have the number. There are a lot of very funny sequences in the film, but there are also a lot of, well, you know, guts on the floor type sequences as well. You seem to have a way, going across all your films, of interweaving comedy and very, very black sort of humour in a fairly unique sort of way. Is this just a general approach that you like to adopt? You like to shock people?
Well, I think that's always useful. I mean, just so that nobody dozes off while the film's around, basically. But I think the shocking is about trying to make people look at things in a different way or consider possibilities they didn't consider before. And humor has always been crucial to everything we do, and I like the idea of trying to find out how far you can go with it, how bizarre and grotesque something can be and still find it funny. I don't know what the limit is. I think that's one of the nice things about doing something like Brazil is to push things as far as you can and see what happens. I mean, we do lose some people along the way, but I mean, it seems most people can go with it. It becomes a bit like a roller coaster ride. So some of the moments when you're laughing the most or the most elated, suddenly, whoop, we pull the rug out from under people, and you plummet. And I think you need that contrast to really make the effect of the fall. I mean, it's just the Icarian theory of comedy, I think, where you've got to fly as close to the sun as possible and then plummet to the earth. And that fall is what's interesting, is how far one can make it.
Do you believe there are sort of limits of good taste?
I think, I don't know what good taste is to begin with. I mean, so I don't, it's a concept I've tried to understand for most of my life and still don't understand it. I think you should be able to laugh at just about anything. I mean, there's a difference at, I suppose, I don't like making fun of things. I mean, or people who can't help themselves. I find that's a very cruel sort of humor. On the other hand, if it's about the human condition, I think one should be able to laugh at just about anything. And I don't know, I think it's, to me, it's the only defense we've got is laughter. It's the one thing that keeps death, madness, all sorts of things from the door. And so to me, it's really important to maintain it at all costs. Almost more important, certainly more important than maintaining things like dignity or good taste or all of those things. And I think it's those aren't very important in life. I think humor is.
I see I have a quote here. If you're going to say something, say it in an entertaining manner. Give people something for their money so that they'll take the sermon home with them after an enjoyable evening. What message do you want people to take away from this film?
Oh, I'd never tell that. I mean, that's up to them. I like the fact that there are different ways of looking at the film, and I like people have different attitudes towards it. It should be like a painting where it hangs there. You decide what to make of it. I don't think it's up to me to give you the answers. Somebody the other day said that Sam was dead at the end of the film. He's not dead, but somebody read it as dead. Somebody in Scandinavia was saying that what they like, it's the first sort of political film they've seen with no ideology. Which is very interesting. I mean, it's all sorts of things. It just gets the discussion going. That's what I like about it. And it just carries on. I mean, that's all these things should be along the way. There should be spots to get people talking and thinking and rethinking. And then goes on, another film gets made by somebody else.
I suppose the mark of a good film in this respect is that it's talked about. Well, one final quotation I will throw at you, attributed to you. Because I dislike being quoted, I find I lie almost constantly when talking about my work. Can we believe anything you've told us this evening?
No, I'm afraid not even that quote was a lie.
Well, whether it was true or not, thank you very much for coming in and speaking to us. It's been a very great pleasure.
Great, thank you. Ta-da.